Okay, good. So I clicked on recording and I hope it's recording.
Okay. This meeting is to continue. Yeah, everything should be fine now. Yeah?
Mm-hmm. And I think so.
Okay. So once again, thanks a lot for this opportunity to give a talk. I'll be talking about the integrable system with spherical singularities. Spherical singularities, so this terminology is not yet fixed, I would say. And this is just the point is that singular fibers will be sphere, and that is quite unusual. And for this reason, following Nguyen Tien Sung, actually, I will refer to these singularities as spherical ones. And what it is about, I will start with with sort of list of references. So there are, for myself, the story starts with the PhD thesis by Damien Bullock. So he did a great job and studied the very nice examples of systems with, in some sense, unusual singularities for integrable Hamiltonian systems. And then so he published one paper in Symplectic Geometry, and there was one more paper by him, Eva Miranda and Nguyen Tien Sung. Also, after this, we started to talk about this, and there was one open problem and about spherical singularities included into this paper. And open problems in finite dimensional systems. But basically, so what I'm going to tell you today, so this is the results of our discussion with Sir Ronan Kerr, our PhD students, mine and Sasha Veselov. And so he was trying to treat these singularities in a more or less systematical way, but still so focusing on examples. So it's one more citation from this open problem paper, there is some particular problem asked by Nguyen Tien Sung. So to basically, this is study topology and geometry and singular fibers with neighborhoods of these singular fibers in this case. But I don't want to discuss this more because it will be clear what these singularities are. I will give you a few examples relevant to my talk, very simple examples, the simplest possible examples. And I want to remind you of some kind of general setting, what we are doing in this when we are talking about singularities of integrable systems, symplectic invariants, and this sort of thing. Some very, very basic stuff. So what is an integrable system in this context? So we have a symplectic manifold, M to N, with symplectic form omega, and an integrable system for us. So this is just a collection of commuting functions, F1, Fn, so these are smooth functions on our manifold. So they pass on commute, and also they are so functionally independent on M almost everywhere. So their flows, Hamiltonian flows are linearly independent almost everywhere, but not everywhere. So we consider the momentum mapping generated or defined by these commuting Hamiltonians. We're looking at the fibration on our manifold M to N generated or associated with this map. More precisely, so if I take the regular value of the momentum map, I consider the preimage of this point. Sometimes so this beam which is disconnected consists of several connected components, and each of those components is understood as a fiber. It's a kind of integral surface of this the integrable Hamiltonian system. I will assume that all fibers are compact, and if A is regular, then so each fiber is a torus. But there are also so singular fibers, so corresponding to those points where the rank of the differential of the momentum mapping drops. There is a set of singular points, and so those fibers which contain at least one singular point are called singular, and they are singular. So something happens to these Liouville tori. So sometimes, so I have two tori, they approach each other, and they collide, and as a result, so one kind of bigger torus appear. Or you have the Liouville torus, and then it's getting kind of more and more narrow. It finally shrinks into a circle, for instance, and then just disappears. So it's all these kind of bifurcations. The standard bifurcations are very well known and studied in many papers. Now that's there is, I would say, a huge theory devoted to the properties, both local and global, of these singular Lagrangian vibrations associated with integrable systems. So what do we want? We want to study or classify or compare the integrable systems in thinking of them of just these vibrations. It means in particular that we are not going to solve these integrable systems or to discuss the behavior of solutions even so these functions f1 fn so generators of these Hamiltonian flows are not important for us. We want to focus on the properties of these singular Lagrangian vibrations. For this reason, so we are free to change these generators F1, Fn by using any diffeomorphism, so it's absolutely allowed. In other words, think of the integrable Hamiltonian system, as I said already, in terms of vibration. So this is M to N, so this is our manifold fiber by tori and some singular fibers, and I denote this vibration projection to the space of fibers. So this is the BN. This BN is much more convenient than the image of the momentum mapping. The base for 1 degree of freedom system, it looks like a graph. For 2 degrees of freedom system, it may look like a kind of complex or CW complex, like stratified manifolds with some regular and singular fibers. But it's absolutely okay. So we think of B as just the base of this vibration. So we know what we want. In what sense I say that it's a one to classify or compare integrable systems. So we basically we want the following. So given two integrable systems, or let's say two singular Lagrangian vibrations, so we want to understand whether or not they are fiber-wise equivalent, fiber-wise symplectical equivalent. So today we'll be talking about symplectic aspect of this story. No, it means that I can find a map, phi capital, between my two manifolds, no, such that this map so can be understood as a lift of the corresponding map between the bases, so it's fiber-wise. So we want, of course, so this phi capital to be a symplectomorphism. And to want to understand what are invariants responsible for the existence of such an equivalence. So that's what we want. Let me remind you that there is a huge theory now about this sort of problems, both local theory, the global theory, semi-global theory. But today I don't want to go into kind of historical discussions here, because my goal today is just to present so three examples and compare them. So that's what I want to do. But still, so some more general words. Symplectic invariants, so that's what we want to do. First of all, let me recall you that the base, in this case, both bases B and B tilde for the first system and the second one. They are endowed with natural Jean-Pierre affine structures. These structures are induced by action variables. More precisely, B and the B tilde, so these bases, they contain some kind of regular strata and singular strata. The action variables are defined on the regular part of the regular strata of B and B tilde, but this is that's enough. You may think of them as sort of singular affine structure or affine structure with singularities. And the singularities are very important, of course. But the main point is that the existence of an affine equivalence between the bases B and B tilde. So this existence is a necessary condition for symplectic fiber-wise isomorphism between the system. So if you want to consider a map phi small between the bases and then lift it up to the map between our symplectic manifolds fiber-wise map, then of course so this phi small must be an affine equivalent. So if B and B tilde are different as affine singular affine manifolds, then definitely there will be no symplectomorphism between our system. So in other words, in very simple terms, so this means that if I consider fiber-wise symplectomorphism, then the action variables are preserved, and that's it. So it's absolutely obvious, and that's not kind of very deep observation, but with very serious consequences. Just to summarize, these affine structures on B and B tilde. So they should be understood as the most natural symplectic invariants for the integrable system. The next question to ask is what else? Are there any other symplectic invariants additional to these affine structures? And it appears that in many cases, so this invariant, this affine structure is already complete. We don't need anything else. I would even formulate this as a general principle. So the general principle basically says that if B and B tilde are equivalent as affine, singular affine manifold, so then this equivalence can be lifted up up to simplex ectomorphism between M and M tilde. The best example is of course the case of toric the manifolds and toric actions, the Belzhan theorem. So Belzhan theorem states exactly the same. So it's if you have two affinally equivalent polytopes, so then the corresponding systems are symplectically equivalent. But it is still true for semitoric systems studied by Pelayo and San Wunbok. It is true for the parabolic singularities and other examples. It is not theorem, but still it makes sense to ask this question here: under which conditions so this is a theorem? So it's very easy to find counterexamples, but as I said, very often this is true. If this principle fails, of course, we need to ask about additional symplectic convergence. Good.
Should questions be left to the end, or
as interruptions? Right now,
Maybe I'll just mention in one word, Rustrumert's Chern class of a completely integrable system,
sure,
which is a class in second cohomology of the base with some specific coefficients, which does measure that twistedness beyond the integral affine structure.
Course,
so so that is a situation which one might expect can be generalized in more situations.
Yes, absolutely.
So
this is the one of examples. So there are other cases when this turns out. No, for instance, if you have a polytope, then the Chern class is
of course
zero.
Because in that case the base has no H2.
Okay, so now let's consider the very simple example of spherical singularity, the singularity I want to discuss today. This is just a geodesic flow on the sphere. The setting is standard. Our symplectic manifold is cotension bundle to the sphere. I think of this cotension bundle as a subset in R6. So there are two vectors, Q and P. So Q belongs to the sphere, to P is orthogonal to Q. Symplectic structure, for some reason, it will be more convenient to deal with Poisson structure. But this Poisson structure is still, so this is just canonical symplectic structure on the tangent bundle, cotangent bundle. So please believe me. And so what is the system? So two commuting functions. So these functions are, so H, this is a standard Hamiltonian for the geodesic flow. It's a Riemannian metric, actually, so nothing else. And since the system is rotationally invariant, so that will be at one additional, so linear integrals, which is in this setting and this coordinate, so this is just a W. U, V, and W, so these are components of momentum in R3, and one of them is the linear integral. So that's a very simple integrable system. So what is interesting about this system? So the following, so if you consider both flows, the generated by H and the generated by F, both are periodic. With one important remark, the flow generated by F, so this linear function is just periodic, because this is just the S1 action, S1, this is rotation, standard rotation in R3. As for H, you know that geodesic lines, so all of them are periodic, but with different periods. And to make the period for all geodesic to be equal to 2 pi, it's very easy. You just need to change the Hamiltonian. Instead of quadratic function, you should consider just square root. Square root of it, yeah? just this. And then the flow will be periodic with period 2 pi. And then therefore, so these two functions, H tilde and F, so they define a torus section on our potential bundle. So it's very nice, but not everywhere. So that is important because, so look at this function H tilde, it is not smooth on the zero section of this one fiber bundle, and for this reason it is not a toric case, but it's sort of quasi-toric, let's say. So to have a torus section everywhere except kind of small set, still our Hamiltonian system, initial one, that was smooth, everything absolutely so was fine. If we now look at the momentum mapping for new Hamiltonians, H tilde and F tilde. So we will see that it looks like a convex. It's not a polytope because it's not compact, but kind of convex domain. And of course, straight lines. So that's why it is no, because of this function, the H tilde and F are action variables. And so what we see here, see both the image and also the integer affine structure. And the integer affine structure, this is just the standard Euclidean structure on this plane. That's what is so interesting. So if you look at this point here, I don't know if you see you should be able to see my cursor. So if you consider singular fiber, then the preimage of this point, so it will be just this Lagrangian sphere. It will be a smooth Lagrangian submanifold, and it's a bit strange because you take it's a regular fiber, it's a torus. This torus approaches this singular fiber, and suddenly instead of this torus, we obtain a sphere. It's kind of counterintuitive, but that's exactly what happens. And also to notice that so if you look at this picture, it's not of Delzant type, because so in Delzant type, you know that the edges of this angle, so they must form a basis of this the integer lattice here, but they don't. They don't. The integer vectors, so they do not form a basis. They form a basis for a sublattice of index 2 in this case. So it's not this singularity is not Delzant type. Good. What is the question I want to ask? Imagine that we have a system with this sort of singularity. What does it mean? It means that our manifold, I consider just the small part of it. So this is just what it is. So this is a neighborhood of a Lagrangian sphere. That's why it's called spherical singularity, Lagrangian sphere. This sphere is a critical submanifold for our Hamiltonian H, and H to behave, I don't know how, but quadratically on each fiber in the sense of, cotangent bundle. And we have another function. I don't know if it is linear or not, but we know that it defines a S1 action. If I consider H tilde, I take a square root. So then that I will get another action, and assume that the image of the momentum mapping is exactly like this, like in the previous picture. So imagine that we have an integrable system like geodesic flow. Is it a geodesic flow, in fact, or not? So that's question number one. So having a system with such properties, is it necessarily symplectically equivalent to the geodetic flow on the sphere or not. Some kind of more general question. So you remember my problem about kind of from affine to symplectic. So I assume that so we have an integrable system, so whose the projections would be the image is just this sort of angle with the standard affine structure, and the preimage of the singular point in the sphere. Is it symplectically equivalent to the geodetic flow or not? In other words, so this principle so works or not? So we wanted to consider other examples of systems with such properties and just to compare them with geodetic flow. And the first example, or better to say the second example, the first example is the geodetic flow on the sphere. The second example, it's a bending flow on the space of polygons. So this integrable system and this manifold was introduced by Karpovich and Milson in a very beautiful paper. But what it is about? The symplectic manifold is what's written here. So this is a space of n gons but in R3, not in R2, but in R3. So we can to move them and flex and so this sort of thing. So we fix the values, the lengths of all edges of this polygon and then consider all of them up to rotations and translations. It's symplectic manifold. Symplectic manifold of dimension 2n-6. Symplectic structure is obtained in the following way. So we think of each edge as a point on the sphere. So we start with direct product of spheres and then take quotient with respect to spheres are endowed with standard symplectic structure. And then we take a quotient with respect to SO3. Diagonal action and under this constraint here. So this constraint means EI here, this is just each edge. And since this line is closed, so the sum of all these vectors is zero. But it's good, it's a standard symplectic reduction. So now what about commuting flow on commuting Hamiltonians? It's also very easy. You take this to polygon, you consider for n gons, we consider n-3 diagonals which do not intersect each other. And consider just the lengths of these diagonals as Hamiltonians. It appears so that these Hamiltonians commute, and moreover, so each of them define S1 action, and this action is very easy actually. So this is the rotation that about this corresponding diagonal. I will try to illustrate this. If you can you see my video here?
Yes,
you see okay, something. So now it will work with certain delay, but anyway, this is my manifold, so which corresponds to the pentagon. Okay, so now, if I consider two diagonals here. The two non-intersecting diagonals. So then if I consider this diagonal here, so then the flow of D1 so will be just rotation of this time. Sorry, it comes with some delay. So if I consider this diagonal here, That's rotation of this kind. But I can sort of, I can rotate them so simultaneously, but to show this, I need the third hand here. Yeah, so third hand is coming. And then I can rotate both. Yeah, and so this is a torus section on our manifold. So great. Yeah, so that's how it works. So it's there is a torus section on our manifold. However, that's it. Thank you. However, it is not toric because you have to be very kind of careful here. Then the reason is that so if these Hamiltonians are not smooth, so it's if diagonal so it becomes zero, so then it's a length. It's not smooth. What is smooth? It's a square of lengths. Yeah. So in general case, this polygon space is not a toric manifold. However, so if you look at the momentum mapping defined by these Hamiltonians H1, HN minus 3, you will see that the image is a polytop. It's a convex polytop, but some vertices are kind of strange. They are not of Bengtson type, like what we've just discussed for the case of a jet elliptic flow. If we consider this pentagon, whose the lengths of all edges are different, a little bit different. So you will see that the image of the momentum mapping looks like this, and it's perfect. It's of Bengtson type, it's Bengtson polytop, and this is a toric manifold, toric system. However, so if you assume that all the edges of all sides of this pentagon are equal to each other, well, then the image of the momentum mapping will be like this. And if you look at this point here, 0.01, that you will see that it's not of Bengtson type. And moreover, so if you consider the preimage of this point, so it's going to be a Lagrangian sphere. That's exactly what we observe for the geodesic flow. That's another example of such a system. And one more example. It's a kind of compact version of my geodesic flow. I will start with the Lie algebra SO4 with the standard Lie Poisson bracket. So that this is a matrix of this bracket here. I use here, you see it more or less the same notation for the geodesic flow. What I'm doing, I simply say, okay, so let's consider as a symplectic manifold. We will consider just an orbit of that joint action in this case defined in these coordinates. So it is defined by two relations of this kind. So. You see, it's different from just a little bit different from what we did in the case of the geodesic flow. For the geodesic flow, that was kind of q square equals constant, but now it's q square plus p square equals constant. Just a small difference. The Hamiltonians are absolutely the same as for the geodesic flow. They still commute, and again, so if I they generate periodic flows, and if instead of h I consider the root, square root, then so that I will get S1 action. So that's I will get torus action. And moreover, so in this case, the flow generators by this function h and f, they are the same for this compact version of the geodesic flow and the original geodesic flow. So it's so-called bi-Hamiltonian system. It's Hamiltonian with respect to the both brackets. It's the dynamics is the same. The vibration is the same. Functions are the same. It's still Lagrangian sphere as a singular fiber. Now, so we have three systems producing sort of all the same sort of singularity. The bipolar equation diagram in this case it will look exactly the same as for geodetic flow, but the compact version. For the geodetic flow that was infinite angle, now in this case it's just triangle here. It is now bounded, but locally it looks the same. Now the question: so these three systems, are they syntactically equivalent or not? For the geodetic flow and its compact version, that I was pretty much sure that this is the case. But for bending flow was quite different. But the answer is yes. So these three systems are equivalent to each other, and so what is nice the fact that you can construct this symplectic isomorphisms explicitly for the geodetic flow in this compact version, so it's easier. So we need to find the map. It's not well written here. So between our symplectic manifolds, but I should consider just small neighborhoods of this Lagrangian sphere. It's not global. It's semi-global in the neighborhood of singular fibers. And what I want. You see, since my functions are the same, I want these functions to be preserved, and I want this kind of S or four Poisson bracket to transform into S or three Poisson bracket. But not globally, of course, it is impossible, but locally, it might be possible, and it is, and the map is very easy. So this is some sort of rescaling or whatever, just like this. You consider Q and P for standard geodetic flow, and you multiply just Q by lambda. The lambda is chosen in such a way that basically, this constraint Q, the absolute value of Q equals one, goes to transforms in this condition here. I can say it in this way. So we have a Lagrangian sphere. This Lagrangian sphere is the same for the both system, but symplectic manifolds, symplectic leaves for these two brackets are different. And I send so one symplectic leaf to the other in the most natural way, let's say. I do not change P, and therefore my Hamiltonians are preserved. The fact that this is symplectomorphism, I don't know if we could predict this or not, but that was easy computation. Something should happen, something nice, because the systems, they behave in a similar way. And if you do this computation, then you will see that it works. For the bending flow, it is the more complicated. And first of all, so we need to introduce some coordinates work in these coordinates. So it can be done actually. So this is my polygon here, and this coordinates I will take. So E1 it's the first edge, E2 is the second, and I introduce two vectors. So Q is difference, E1 minus E2, P is sum, E1 plus E2. Then they satisfy conditions exactly the same as for the compact version of the geodesic flow. And now, so in these coordinates, in new coordinates, in Q and P, I need to write down syntactic structure, which is obtained by means of reduction. This can be done, and that's what you will see. And what is important here, it is, so if you consider just the higher order terms or the linear terms here, they are exactly the same as for SO4 bracket. But there are some additional terms. It's some sort of nonlinear perturbation of this bracket. Commuting Hamiltonians are the first one is just the same as before, and the second, this is the second length of the second diagonal, so can be computed. It is like this. After this, you need to construct a map. I will show you that explicit form for this map. It looks kind of horrible here, but it is absolutely explicit. So how this map was sort of guessed? Of course, we need functions, Hamiltonians for one system to go to Hamiltonians of the second system. You can do it. It's not very difficult. And you can, so since the trajectories are just circles, you can make this map in such a way that each circle goes to the corresponding circle of the second system. The flows are preserved. And therefore, so you will see that these conditions, this constraint for it's not so difficult to do. To construct a map such that these conditions that M4 goes to itself, basically. Also, that the Hamiltonians, the generators transform in the right way. Also, the flows transform in the right way as we need. But then the question, what happens to the symplectic form under this transformation? Because it's absolutely unclear. No, and that was like a miracle. You compute this with metal. It is not so easy to do this transformation. And they will see that. So this nonlinear perturbation disappears, and you will get exactly SO4 sub-bracket. And by the way, I should explain that. This non-compact version was introduced just because we observed that this bracket here is a SO4 bracket, not the one for the standard jet flow. It's compact version. So that was kind of a bridge between the two systems, jet flow and baking flow. It is located right in between them. So it works. We can ask I'm about to finish. The simplified version of problem one. Assume that we have a geodesic flow on the sphere, and we introduce a new symplectic structure. Very nice symplectic structure, such that these functions, Hamiltonians of the geodesic flow, still commute. The flows are the same as before, but that's exactly what we did when we tried to construct a symplectomorphism. Omega hat and omega, they're still different. They can be different. Can we kind of still to do something to make them the same? So can we construct a symplectomorphism which preserves Hamiltonians and sends one bracket to the other? That's the one question. And the other question, it's a similar thing, but a little bit stronger. Instead of sending Hamiltonians to Hamiltonians and flows to flows, we will assume that the actions are the same. Actions for omega and for omega hat are the same. Is it still true that we can modify a little bit our system, modifying use a certain syntactic morphism which does this job, sends one system to the other. That is not clear. The answer to the first question is yes, Коля Мартинчук did it, proved that you can always construct a map which does this job, so the file exists. The question two, it is still not clear. But as I say, for the system with this kind of singularities, there are a lot of open problems, basically of the same type. So not just to finish, I tell, if you consider geodetic flow on SO3, on S3, on three-dimensional sphere. So then you will see that the momentum mapping, if you do more or less same tricks as I explained, so the momentum mapping will look like this. It's again a convex body, some sort of corner with nice properties, and the preimage of the vertex is three-dimensional sphere, three-dimensional Lagrangian sphere. For bending flows on the hexagon space, you will have the same kind of vertex here, and also for Gelfand-Sedwin system, so this vertex here is also of this kind. Are they symmetric to each other? Maybe up to some covering map or not. It's a lot of questions. Or more general, of course, question is of course if you have this non Belzan polytope, does it allow us to reconstruct synthetic structure or not? So that's. I believe that this is a very interesting class of singularities. So thank you for your attention. That's it. Yeah, thank you. Sorry for the delay.
Thanks a lot for your talk. And are there questions?